Vrinda said. We are going to be reading from Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Leela, chapter 22, verse number 29. Yes. So let's begin with the invocation prayers. Om Agyana Timirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nitya Ananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shiva Sadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Leela, chapter 22, verse number 29. Jnani Jivan Mukta Dasha Painu Kari Mani, Vastuta Buddhi Shuddha Nahi Krishna Bhakti Vini. Translation? There are many philosophical speculators, jnanis, belonging to the Mayavad school who consider themselves liberated and call themselves Narayan. But their intelligence is not purified unless they engage in Krishna's devotional service. So no purport. So we'll go to the next verse, please. Verse number 30, which is like this. Yenye Ravindaksha Vimukta Maninas, Tvai Asta Bhavat Avishuddha Buddhayaha, Aruya Krichena Parampadam Tataha, Patantyado Nadrita Yushmad Angrayaha. Translation, O lotus-eyed one, those who think they are liberated in this life but do not render devotional service to you must be of impure intelligence. Although they accept severe austerities and penances and rise to the spiritual position to impersonal Brahman realization, they fall down again because they neglect to worship your lotus feet. And the purport simply says that this is a verse directly quoted from Srimad Bhagavatam 10:2:32. So we'll go to the next verse, please. Thank you. And this is the verse we're going to focus on today, which is a very famous verse and often quoted by Srila Prabhupada. Krishna Surya Sama Maya Haya Andhakara Yaha Krishna Taha Nahi Maya Radhikara. Translation, Krishna is compared to sunshine and Maya is compared to darkness. Wherever there is sunshine, there cannot be darkness. As soon as one takes to Krishna consciousness, the darkness of illusion, the influence of the external energy will immediately vanish. So the purport and translation by Srila Prabhupada, the purport goes as follows. In Srimad Bhagavatam 2.9.34, it is stated, Ritte rittam yata yat pratiyeta na pratiyeta chat na Ritte rittam yat pratiyeta na pratiyeta chatmani tadvidyadatmano mayam Yatha bhaso yatha tamaha. What appears to be truth without me is certainly my illusory energy, for nothing can exist without me. It is like a reflection of a real light in the shadows, for in the light there are neither shadows nor reflections. Wherever there is light, there cannot be darkness. When a living entity becomes Krishna conscious, he is immediately relieved of all material lusty desires. Lusty desires and greed are associated with rajas and tamas, passion and darkness. When one becomes Krishna conscious, the modes of passion and darkness immediately vanish, and then the mode of goodness, sattva guna, remains. When one is situated in the mode of goodness, he can make spiritual advancement and understand things clearly. This position is not possible for everyone. When a person is Krishna conscious, he continuously thinks, hears about Krishna, thinks about him, worships him, and serves him as a devotee. If he remains in Krishna consciousness in this way, the darkness of Maya certainly will not be able to touch him. ओम अज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपकदामयं ददाति स्वापदान्तिकम्। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासादि गौर भक्तवृन्द। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे रामा 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 हरे हरे। सो इफ यू कैन रिमेम्बर इन दिस चैप्टर द लॉर्ड हिमसेल्फ लॉर्ड चैतन्य इज एक्सप्लेनिंग द प्रोसेस ऑफ डिवोशनल सर्विस एंड ही एस्टैब्लिशेस डिवोशनल सर्विस एज द सुप्रीम पाथ। He clearly says that Karmakandis, Jnana Yogis, Hatha Yogis, all the others, they're simply wasting time because they're taking a very roundabout, very troublesome path to actually reach the same goal, Krishna. So why not take to the simple direct path of devotional service? Excuse me one moment, please. Thank you. So you see, we want to be very much clear in our understanding of why bhakti is the highest, because it is the direct path to Krishna. Krishna himself says in the Bhagavad Gita, they do so in a very troublesome way. They also worship me, but they do so in a way that is very troublesome because it involves so much torture, because austerities and penances take a huge toll. And right now in this age of Kali, we are not capable of it also. Very, very few people are capable of it. And even after all that trouble, what do the jnanis achieve? The impersonal Brahman effulgence. And once they come to the impersonal Brahman effulgence, it's like being in a vast open space all alone. However, a brilliant effulgent with not a soul, there's no relationship. And so they fall down again to the material world. So the whole point is, again, we have to begin that cycle, again, trying to reach. So it's just considered useless labor if we go through all these different paths rather than taking to the simple, direct, easy, sublime, and meaningful, and enriching, and ultimately self-realizing. What is the meaning of self-realization? Meaning realizing the self. And what is the self? Part and parcel of Krishna. Each one of us is a tiny, fragmental part of Krishna, full of knowledge, full of bliss, and eternal. But do we really realize that position now? No. We are covered with this material body, the gross material body, and then the subtle body with the mind, intelligence, false ego. And all that it gives us is trouble. So unless we use this material mind and material body in Krishna's service, then it becomes more and more spiritualized, more and more Krishnaized. And then we begin to understand the real thing, the real picture. Instead of living in the world of shadows and reflections, we come into the light. Asatoma satgamaya, tamasoma jyotirgamaya, mrityorma amritam gamaya. What is the meaning of that? Come into the truth from the falseness or the illusion. Come into eternal life by giving up temporary material life. And come and taste real nectar. Mrityu, and give up repeated birth and death. So this is such a wonderful process. This is such a joyful process. Su sukham kartum avyayam. Krishna says in the 9th chapter of the Gita, second verse, he says, this is very joyful process. And it gives the goal, the end result is self-realization. So not only the result is very nice, but the path is also very joyful. Devotional service is a joyful process. And as we awaken more and more to who we really are, we get situated in the mode of goodness. We rise above tamagun and rajagun, which is what generally most of us are infected with in Kali Yuga, which is what the mode of passion and the mode of ignorance. And we slowly get purified and we come to the mode of goodness, which is known as sattvagun. So what is Krishna, what is Lord Chaitanya explaining over here? That when you come into the light, there is no more darkness. There is no more illusion. There is no more reflection. There is no more bewilderment. There is no more confusion. And Krishna also says, What appears to be truth without me is certainly my illusory energy, for nothing can exist without me. Krishna says this in Bhagavad Gita again, in verse number 7 of chapter 7. Matta partaram nanya kinchit asti dhananjaya maya idam sarvaprotham sutre mani gana iva. My dear Arjuna, everything rests upon me as pearls on a thread. There is no more truth superior to me. So just think of a pearl necklace. How nicely it is strung on a thread. One pearl after another, after another, after another. But you just break the thread and all the pearls are just scattered here and there. You see? But now with Krishna, the thread holding everything together, everything is perfect. And that is how everything rests in him, on him, within him. And there is nothing that can exist without Krishna, because Krishna is the source of everything. Aham sarvasya prabhavo mata sarvam pravartate iti matva bhajante bam buddha bhava samanvitaha. Chapter 10 of Gita, Krishna explains, there is no more truth superior to me. I am the source of all spiritual and material worlds. Everything emanates from me, and the wise who perfectly know this engage in my devotional service and worship me with all their hearts. So this is Krishna giving us the light of knowledge. He says, I come and I destroy with the shining lamp of knowledge the darkness born of ignorance. And we can see, we look around us, we look at people who have been practicing sincerely Krishna consciousness for many decades and years, how they are. They're effulgent. They're radiant. Why? Because they have become purified of all the lower modes, and they are more and more situated in the modes of goodness. They're more and more situated in Krishna rather than in Maya. We cannot claim to be like that. We are still struggling with the modes of passion and ignorance, and we're struggling to reach the mode of goodness. But this is a good struggle, for it will make us nicely situated to then make progress in bhakti yoga. Because unless one comes to the mode of goodness, at least, there's no question really of devotional service. Even right now, a devotional service is mixed. So therefore, the spiritual master purifies our mixed devotional service and then offers it to Krishna. Because Krishna is not obliged to take anything that's not pure. So it's the mercy of the spiritual master that allows us to even practice devotional service and offer our love, whatever little bit is there, after 98% of the love is taken up by all the gadgets and gizmos that we love. Then we have a little bit left over for Krishna, perhaps. But we must try to understand that this is actually a means of purification. This is actually going to bring me to who I really am. I am not this body. I'm not this mind. I'm not this designation. I'm not this particular relationship or this particular position or anything in this material world. The real me has nothing to do with this material energy. The real me is with Krishna in the spiritual world. It's unfortunate that I have rebelled against Krishna and have come into this world of darkness. Actually, these material worlds are called dark worlds. Why? Because we need the sun, we need the moon, we need electricity, we need artificial means of lighting up everything so that, you know, we can see things. We can, just one moment, please. I'm getting a little distracted. So we want to understand our position, and we want to come into that real position, which is giving up the lower modes and coming to the real mode where we can begin our devotional service nicely. And then we transcend that mode of goodness to go into transcendence, as it is called, which is rising above all the material modes and being situated in our original position of pure love for Krishna. So what is that person like? When a person is Krishna conscious, let's look at the last two lines. He continuously hears about Krishna, thinks about him, worships him, and serves him as a devotee. And if he remains in Krishna consciousness in this way, the darkness of Maya certainly will not be able to touch him. See how beautifully the description is given of a person fully in Krishna consciousness. And Krishna himself in the Bhagavad Gita. Let's go to verse 1865, Vrinda, if you don't mind.
Yeah, sure, Mataji.
That's a beautiful verse where Krishna is saying how to become Krishna conscious in a nutshell. These four things, if we do it very nicely, we will become Krishna conscious one day. Manmana bhava madbhakto madhyaji mam namaskuru mam evaishyasi satyam te pratijane priyosi me. What does that mean? Always think of me. Become my devotee. Offer your homage unto me and worship me. Thus, being absorbed in me, surely you will come to me. I promise you this because you are my very dear friend. And there's a beautiful purport where Srila Prabhupada explains that our lives should be molded in such a way that 24 hours we are thinking of Krishna. Here it is. Thank you, Vrinda. Always think of me, become my devotee, worship me, and offer your homage unto me. Thus you will come to me without fail. I promise you this because you are my very dear friend. And the purport. The most confidential part of knowledge is that one should become a pure devotee of Krishna and always think of him and act for him. One should not become an official meditator. Life should be so molded that one will always have the chance to think of Krishna. One should always act in such a way that all his daily activities are in connection with Krishna. He should arrange his life in such a way that throughout the 24 hours, he cannot but think of Krishna. And the Lord's promise is that anyone who is in such pure Krishna consciousness will certainly return to the abode of Krishna. Jai! Isn't this wonderful? Where he will be engaged in the association of Krishna face to face. Haribol! This most confidential part of knowledge is spoken to Arjuna because he is the dear friend of Krishna. Everyone who follows the path of Arjun can become a dear friend to Krishna, please, and obtain the same perfection as Arjuna. These words stress that one should concentrate his mind upon Krishna, the very form with two hands carrying a flute, the bluish boy with a beautiful face and peacock feathers in his hair. There are descriptions of Krishna found in the Brahma Samhita and other literatures. One should fix his mind on this original form of Godhead Krishna. One should not even divert his attention to other forms of the Lord. The Lord has multi forms as Vishnu, Narayan, Ram, Varaha, etc. But a devotee should concentrate his mind on the form that was present before Arjun. Concentration of the mind on the forms of Krishna, on the form of Krishna, constitutes the most confidential part of knowledge. And this is disclosed to Arjuna because Arjuna is the most dear friend of Krishna. So what a beautiful formula Krishna is giving us. Always think of me, become my devotee, worship me and offer your homage to me. Thus you will come to me without fail. I promise you this because you are my very dear friend. Now Krishna, when he makes a promise, he keeps it. In fact, whatever he says he will do for his devotee, he will do for his devotee. So when he says, you become absorbed in me and you will come to me, I promise you this, Krishna will keep his promise. So what do we have to do? We have to do these four things. Always think of Krishna, become his devotee, worship Krishna, offer all our love, our devotion, our activities, our mind, our intelligence, our life, our wealth, our relationships. Joki chumora arpilu tua pade nanda kishora. What does Bhaktivinoda Thakur sing? Manasa deho geho joki chumora arpilu tua pade nanda kishora. Whatever is mine, home, heart, wealth, wife, children, everything, I simply surrender it to you, my Lord, because it's yours anyway. What is mine? Nothing is mine. So we have all these wonderful literatures. We have all these wonderful lessons to learn from the Srimad Bhagavatam and the lives of the great devotees who have shown by their example how to come back to Krishna. Srila Prabhupada is a Nitya Siddha. He's an eternally liberated personality, Shaktyavesh avatar, who came down from the spiritual world to teach us Krishna consciousness. And he made other great souls like our spiritual masters, who in turn are teaching us to follow the path of bhakti very purely, very nicely, very sincerely, very lovingly, with devotion to Krishna, so that we will go back home to Krishna. The whole purpose of Krishna consciousness is to come out of the darkness and into the light. Isn't it? We want to make our, actually, the purpose of our life is to become a shining light. We are meant to give our light to others. How will we give that light if we are not lighted up? And how will we light ourselves up? By the process of Krishna consciousness. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. So you see, in all traditions, whether it's Krishna consciousness or Christianity or Quran, the message is the same. What is that message? This is not your home. You belong to Krishna, to God in the spiritual world. And you're meant to live beside there eternally, happily, in love with Krishna. There, every soul is completely in love with Krishna. And there is only one desire, one motivation, one activity, lovingly pleasing Krishna, serving Krishna. There's no other thought, there's no other desire, there's no conflict, there's no disharmony, there's no disagreement. All living entities are simply serving Krishna, madly in love with him. Can you even imagine this? A blade of grass, a tree, a flower, a butterfly, a bee, everyone madly in love with Krishna and doing everything to serve Krishna. And this is who we really are. We have actually lost our way and come here to this material world. Just imagine, once we were with Krishna, and who knows what we were in the spiritual world. So now we are trying to get back what we have lost. When Srila Prabhupada was asked, what have you come here for? You know, we have churches, we have mosques, we have synagogue, we have everything. And Srila Prabhupada said, I have come to teach you what you have forgotten. I have come to teach you how to love Krishna. And when Srila Prabhupada was asked, what is religion? What is real religion? He said, real religion means how to love God. So any real religion that is teaching you to love God, bona fide religion. But here we are, we know who is Krishna, who is God. We have his name, Srila Prabhupada said. We have his address. We know who his associates are. We know what he likes to eat, how he likes to dress, what he likes to do, what his activities are. Krishna is so nice. Srila Prabhupada said, Krishna is so nice. Krishna is so wonderful. So by engaging more and more in the process of bhakti, what will happen to us? We will also become more and more in love with Krishna and less and less and less in love with Maya. Maya is what has kept us in this network of repeated birth and death, my dear spirit souls, for millions of lifetimes. And not just in the human form of life, in every species of life we have gone through. Srila Prabhupada said, your soul has traversed all the 8,400,000 species of life. And now you have come to the human form of life. Such a rare opportunity. This is the one loophole that we can use to get out permanently of the cycle of repeated birth and death and go back to Krishna. So why not? Why should we lose this chance? We have hit the jackpot. Lord Chaitanya just came and gave it such a simple process. Just chant. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, 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 Hare Hare. And go back to Krishna. So simple, so sweet, so sublime, so easy. So as we chant and as we make our chanting more and more concentrated, more and more focused, more and more determined to connect with Krishna, to serve Krishna, we will understand slowly how we are meant to serve Krishna. We will get nice instructions how to serve Krishna. And by pleasing the spiritual master, we can make nice progress on the path of bhakti and ultimately be situated very nicely. At least we can come to Bhajana Kriya, which is what is happening today for Zenka. I'm eager to know what's her new spiritual name. That's Bhajana Kriya. That's initiation. Then from there, we do Anartha Nivritti. Then from Anartha Nivritti, we become steady by getting rid of all our anarthas and come to the stage of Nishtha, which is steadiness, which is a difficult stage to reach because we are still wobbling, you know, and falling off here and there. But if we keep persisting, the day will come when we become very steady in our devotional service and we make nice progress further and further. Then we get a little taste, ruchi. We get a sweet taste for Krishna's name, for the services, for association, for everything. That's called ruchi. After that is asakti and bhava and prema. Finally, we reach Krishna prema, pure love of Krishna. Of course, that's a very far off goal. Right now, if we are lucky, if we are initiated to try to struggle our way through anartha nivritti and reach nishtha, that would be great. Personally speaking, still struggling with anartha nivritti. But we know at least we are on the right path. At least we know we are on the right road. At least we know after wandering for millions of lifetimes, we have come to the real process, which will really take us back. There's no more, you know, cheating going on because this is pure devotional service. The path of pure devotional service is being given to us over here. And it's up to us now how much we want to apply this knowledge, how much we want to practice this knowledge, and how much we want to make our lives perfect. That is up to us. As Guru Maharaj says, you can stay here as long as you want. But the thing is, we don't want to stay here. What is the point of staying here? Another birth, another death, another birth, another death. And we have done this. So let us come out of the darkness into the light. And that light is the light of knowledge. That light is the light of Krishna consciousness. That light is the light of knowing who we really are. Sat Chit Ananda Vigraha. And when we come to this knowledge, there's no more illusion. We can't hide anymore. As they say in the mafia, you can't leave now. You know too much. You know that? They say like that. So once you come to Krishna consciousness, even if you want to leave, the teachings which are there, you can never really leave because in the back of your mind, you know, this is the eternal and supreme truth. There is no more truth higher than this. So even if you try and get away, Krishna won't let you go. So my dear spirit souls, I hope that this has been enlivening and hopefully enlightening and enriching for you. I think that, let's see, I'm just going to take a quick look and see if I missed out any point in the purport or, okay. So Lord, let me talk a little bit about Lord Chaitanya because we're talking about Chaitanya Charitamrita. Lord Chaitanya is so merciful, so magnanimous, so munificent, so compassionate, so liberal, so kind, so generous that such an incarnation has never been seen before. He's so merciful when he's asked, who is a Vaishnava? He says, anyone who takes the name of Krishna, he's a Vaishnava. Just once you take the name of Krishna and your path of liberation begins. How merciful is that? Just imagine. You just say the name of Krishna once and Lord Chaitanya is happy and satisfied and he makes the way for you to come closer and closer to him. So really, this is the most, it couldn't get any better. It couldn't get any easier because this age of Kali is so vitiated. The atmosphere is so vitiated. Man has very short life. There are so many problems, you know, surrounding us. Lord Chaitanya said, let's make it easy. Let's make it simple. Let's make it quick. Let them come back quickly to me. And so he gave this process of Krishna consciousness. Chant Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Krishna Krishna. Hare Hare. Hare Rama. Hare Rama. Rama Rama. Hare Hare. And go back home, back to Krishna, that lovely, beautiful, transcendental boy, transcendental blue boy with peacock feather in his hair and yellow silk dhoti is playing on his transcendental flute and mesmerizing everybody by the sweetness of that flute. So that's our home, actually, and not this material world where there's danger at every step. Padam padam yad vipadam na tesham. Every moment surrounded by danger, surrounded by the three miseries constantly plaguing us. But there's one way to rise above it, and that is the process of Krishna consciousness. We keep chanting, we keep associating with Krishna, and slowly, slowly, we are like wet wood now. Srila Prabhupada described, we are like wet wood now. But if you stay in the fire, slowly one day you will become dry. So there's great hope, because Lord Chaitanya is so merciful and he's given this process and tells, don't waste your time doing jnana yoga, karma yoga, this yoga, that yoga. Just take to bhakti yoga. Make your life successful and then help others make their life successful by giving them the process of bhakti yoga. So thank you very much for listening so patiently. I really pray that you are satisfied by my humble service that Guru Maharaj has ordered me to do. Please forgive me if I have disappointed you in some way, or fallen short of your expectations, or not touched upon some points you had hoped for. And please bless me so I can do better. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Thank you so much. As always, it was a beautiful class. Always you are giving these inspiring classes and encouraging us to fix in our Krishna consciousness. Your classes are very wonderful, Mataji. Thank you.
You're very kind to encourage me by saying those kind words. I'm very sure that there was...
I mean it, Mataji.
You're kindly overlooking all of them.
I really mean what I said, Mataji. Your classes are very nice. I can really see that the verse from Bhagavad Gita is really inspiring verse for you. And many times you talk about that verse. It is a beautiful verse to actually meditate upon always. So thank you for that. I request devotees, if there are any questions, comments, realizations, please go ahead and share. Thank you.
It would be really nice if everybody put on their cameras.
Rishabh Prabhuji has raised hand. Prabhuji, please go ahead.
Mm-hmm. You're on mute, my dear Rishabh Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, dear mother, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to you, all glories to all the Vaishnavas of the Lord.
All glories to His Holiness Chandamali Swami Guru Maharaj Ki.
Jai.
My take humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to Gurudev.
Jai. Thank you very much. Lately, I was talking with many devotees, many senior devotees, and we were kind of trying to churn on, like, I really like a few points that you made. And one of the points was really interesting. We were saying, like, you know, let's not take to any other process than bhakti yoga, let's stick to bhakti yoga. But then it was really interesting was the statistics of how many people actually in the first 10 years, how many people drop out from bhakti yoga. Do you know that? Do you know that statistics?
Mm-mm.
That's interesting. So actually, in the first 10 years, 90% of devotees fall out from the West. I would not say so much in Indian congregations that actually there are so many dropouts, but Western, when I see actually Western people, there are like 90% of Western people drop out in the first 10 years.
Then
in the next 20 years, half of them who left, who actually were there, they left after that.
Mm-hmm.
So, do you have any comments on that? Like, how comes? So, we should stick to it, but then people aren't able to stick to it. So, how to understand this statistic? Maybe if you have some idea or lightning, please.
Yes, a very good question. Actually, when Srila Prabhupada was also asked, he said, you know, don't be surprised how many leave, be surprised how many stay. He said that because this is a very You know, Srila Prabhupada said, when you have to buy a diamond, you have to pay the price. You see, if you're trying for some cheap thing, you know, you can just pay a few dollars and get it. But if you're trying to buy a very costly, very expensive diamond, you have to pay a very high price. And not all are willing to do that. Giving up all my material attachments, what? Giving up Facebook, Instagram, and my friends, and my hangouts, and my this and that? No, 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 I cannot do that. I cannot give up this. I cannot give up that. So our material attachments and our material desires and our fruitive mentality is very deep, Prabhu, very deep. It goes back millions of lifetimes. So it's not so easy for us to give up this. And only one thing will keep us going. What is that? Real desire to go back to Krishna. If we don't have that real desire, if we don't have that greed to go back to Krishna, then the things of this world will be very attractive. And we will say, oh my gosh, who's going to get up for Mangal Arati? Oh my gosh, 16 rounds, are you kidding? Can I just get away with like 8 rounds? Why does it have to be so hard? You mean I cannot go and have a little tipple now and then at the roadside pub? What? Are you saying give up drinking, give up drugging, give up sexing, give up alcohol, give up this, give up that, give up meat eating, give up, give up, give up, give up tea, coffee even? No intoxicants, no this, no that, no that, no that. So many no's. What is this? So, because we have no taste for devotional service and we have developed great taste for all these other things, the process of bhakti yoga is not so simple. Our tongue, you know, is coated with that bitter taste of, you know, the things of this world, and we're used to that. So, and then while we're trying to get rid of all that taste for lower things, there's a transition period where you may not experience, you know, all bliss and all joy and all this and all that, because all the impurities are coming to the surface. And we don't like to deal with that. We don't like to face those dark, dirty things in our heart. And that's the point where many people cave in and jump ship, as they say. So anartha nivritti is what separates the men from the boys and the girls from the women, from the ladies. So those who are serious in bhakti, they will stick around through that hard, hard process of anartha nivritti. And then with steadiness and taste developing, then, you know, our attraction for Krishna increasing, devotional service, then we will start, you know, really feeling, oh, I want to do bhakti yoga. But until then, it's really very hard to keep powering through our anarthas. And that is why a lot of people leave, because it's very hard to struggle through that phase. That's my take on it. But you're welcome to ask Gurudev.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Because we were like thinking of what about these 90% of people that drop out? So like, how could help them? You know, yeah, like we as devotees, we are not satisfied with only 10% of people staying, you know.
Srila Prabhupada said, when someone leaves, it's 50% their fault, it's 50% our fault. So we cannot do anything about their 50%, but we have to take responsibility for our 50%, which means our temples, our institutions should become places of love and trust. There has to be a great feeling of loving care that every devotee needs to feel. That is different from the outside world. Otherwise, why will they stay in Krishna consciousness? And this is where we are really lacking relationships. We need to make every soul understand they're part of our family, and that they, whatever their state, their situation, their likes, their dislikes, their demeanor, their dress, their this, whatever it may be, that soul has walked into the temple and he or she is very dear to Krishna. I may not be able to see that, but Krishna sees them like that. And my duty is to honor, care, respect. And if I'm in a position of authority, then it's my duty to serve them in such a way that they make nice progress in Krishna consciousness. We really have to get this understanding that unless we take care of our devotees, unless we really make every soul feels their shelter here, they will run somewhere else, because if they're not feeling sheltered, they're not feeling cared for, they're not feeling understood or heard. And how many of our temples are like that, where there's a nice devotee care committee or there's a nice devotee care system set up? Very few. Till now, we are a fledgling institute, so we are still focused on book distribution, who'll do the DT worship, who'll get the garland, and who'll buy the bhog, and who'll do this, and who'll do that. But I'm asking, who'll take care of devotees? Devotees are the real treasure of this movement. A happy devotee is the best advertisement for Krishna consciousness. And a sad, morose, lonely, unhappy devotee is a very, very sad reflection on us. What are we not doing right? Why are we not showing the love and care the devotee needs? So yeah, we have a lot of work to do in this area. And my genuine and sincere hope is that the next phase of our movement will focus on relationships. I mean, we have the temples, we have the institutes now, we have this, we have that. But what about relationships? What about devotee care?
Thank you very much. Jai.
Hare Krishna. Thank you. You really got me on my soapbox now. Devotee care is a very, very dear concept to me. I really am very, very much, you know, concerned that every devotee, you know, there are so many sections of our society that are so disenfranchised. Women, children, you know, people who are differently abled, people who are mentally challenged, people who are, you know, differently inclined. You know, so many sections of society are marginalized or even maybe, you know, rejected sometimes. It's a very, I think we have a lot of growing up to do, but at least recognizing that there's work to be done in this area is at least one step. You know, they say for a problem, acknowledging that there's a problem is like 50% of the solution. So we need to look at our, you know, selves and see, how am I, you know, when you know, I'm dealing with devotees, what are the ways I'm putting off people maybe? What are the ways I'm having my biases and prejudices coming out? Because we have our anarthas. We have our own ideas. Oh, Chinese people, they are like that. Oh, look at those Bengalis. Oh my God, they are like this and they are like that. We have all these ideas about people and who are different from us. Of course, we are wonderful. There's nothing wrong with us. But others can see all the 100 problems we have, which we cannot see. So we really have to work on patience, tolerance, acceptance, understanding, and constantly reminding ourselves of what Prabhupada has given us, a house in which the whole world can live peacefully by extending ourselves and saying, this is a spirit soul. This is a person who has the right to love and serve Krishna in the way he or she wants. There's a lot of work we need to do in this area. I absolutely am very sure about that, and I'm very vociferous about it also.
Thank you, Mataji. That was a wonderful answer. I also agree to many of the points about devotee care. Like you said, it is not there in many temples, and it is so much required. Thank you. I request devotees, if there are any more questions or realizations, please go ahead.
I especially say that because being in the woman's body, I have experienced so much at the hands of men. And I just think to myself, you know, here I am with whatever position I have, education I have, and I'm treated like this. What about those poor souls who cannot speak up, who cannot voice their, you know, feelings, or who are so scared even to say anything? What about those people? How they must be feeling, suffering silently for maybe decades, you know? Black people in the US and women, children. Yeah, I mean, this, oh, Krishna, we have a lot of work to do. Let's just put it that way.
Yes, great Prabhu, please go ahead.
Hare Krishna, Madhashi Devi, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to you, all glories to Srila Prabhupada. Mother Shridevi, you...
Ved Prabhu, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Prabhupada, all glories to our Gurudev.
Mataji, you were speaking on, you know, interfaith, and I was listening to a lecture by Chandramani Maharaj the other day, and he was talking about how a lot of our issues, a lot of the challenges we face within, you know, these interfaith minglings, and you even brought it up in your lecture today. Thank you so much for that. Talking about, you know, how we point fingers, oh, you're in my, I'm in my, when really, as you said, we should have this position of, you know, I am a shining light. I have something to offer to, you know, all the unalloyed devotees and devotees of the world. So how can we, you know, strengthen our interfaith mingling? You know, Srila Prabhupada says with, you know, with Krishna consciousness, it can help us learn, you know, other religions. So is there, you know, validity in trying to continue to be, as you said, that seeker mentality and learn like inklings of other religions to, you know, strengthen that bond and show others that it's all one and the same, you know, kind of strengthen that and interfaith, as you were saying, Mataji, Hare Krishna.
Yeah, it's a very good question, and I'm going to answer it in a couple of different ways. One, I want to remind us all of a very great soul, Mother Krishna Nandini. She was born in a woman's body, in a black body in America, and she went on to do tremendous work in the interfaith area. She was married to a Muslim man, and she started Grihastha Vision Team because she got a dream where Prabhupada told her, you teach people how to have a Krishna conscious family life. So here's an example of a great soul who was a Krishna conscious devotee, and she impacted so many people's lives, not just Hare Krishna's. She had an impact on people of so many different religious traditions, faiths, inclinations, likings, desires. I mean, she was a very special personality because she is a very special personality because now her legacy continues, her example continues, her life is a shining example for us all to follow, that we need to understand that it's not just Hare Krishna who have the corner on the truth, you know. There are very pious Christians, there are very pious people of other faith too, who are very sincerely practicing their faith and who may be closer to God than me. Who knows? Saint Teresa of Avila, Saint Francis of Assisi, like that. There are many great saints in other traditions who are very Krishna conscious, very God conscious. As we begin our Krishna conscious journey, however, it's most important for us to get very grounded in our own faith, our own philosophy, our own principles and understandings, so that we are able to operate from a strong foundation. And then we can also talk to other people of other faiths. We can talk from a position of strength without getting confused ourselves. That's one thing I would like to say. And second, we will be respected because we are practicing our own faith nicely, and we can be an example of what we are trying to preach, that genuine love means faith, tolerance and understanding and acceptance of everyone where they are at, and understanding that this person is part and parcel of Krishna, whether he's a Muslim or a Jew or a Jain or a Parsi or a Sikh or a Buddhist or a, you know, Baha'i or whatever it may be. I mean, I was till now part of an interfaith organization for climate change in the Greater New Orleans Interfaith Climate Coalition. So I interacted with a lot of people of other faiths. And, you know, being respectful of others is the first thing. We must understand that every person is part and parcel of Krishna, though I may not agree with their beliefs, or I may not even, you know, subscribe to those beliefs, but being respectful of the bona fide religious paths and being a kind person. I think that stands out for everyone. Being respectful and being grounded in our own philosophy is a good starting point. And then from there, you can go further. And then if you wish, you can explore other, you know, what are the tenets of their faith and try to see commonalities. There's a book actually written, I think, by Satyaraj Das, East-West Dialogues, where he's speaking about Krishna conscious philosophy with a Christian priest, and they're trying to find some common ground. I don't think it's in print anymore. You may have to really search for it. But that's a very nice book to have on hand when talking to Christians. And I don't know whether it would be safe for a person who's a beginner to study other faiths, you know, what to say, unless you're highly inclined in that direction, in that way, you're very, very, you know, academically minded, and you're very scholarly, and that's your bent of mind, and your spiritual master is asking you to do that, then guided by the spiritual master, yes. But without the spiritual master's guidance, I wouldn't agree that we must study other faiths and other traditions, what they have to say, because we might get confused in our, you know, path of bhakti. Until we become very solidly grounded, I would say, let's get, you know, familiar with what we need to know first. That's what I would say. But of course, I'm happy for you to ask Guru Maharaj and clarify with him. He will give you the best answer.
No, I cut out for that last like 10 seconds, Mataji, but I caught the majority of that. Thank you. Thank you so much. No, I do believe it is like, we must be grounded in our own faith. As I said in the beginning of the question, Srila Prabhupada, you know, told us, you know, pick up this Krishna consciousness and it will only help you from, you know, where you began, like the day before you realized Krishna.
Okay. The last 10 seconds I just said, please feel free to ask Guru Maharaj because he will give you the best answer.
Thank you, Mataji, for that answer. Anyone else wants to ask any other question or share any realization at this point? Please go ahead. Okay. I don't see any hand raised or any question in the chat, Mataji.
Okay.
So with your permission, then should we stop here, Mataji?
Yes, that's perfectly all right with me. Thank you all very much for so patiently listening to me raving and ranting. I'm so sorry. Once I get on my soapbox, you know, that's it. No stopping me. So thank you.
Oh, Mataji. We like to hear you, Mataji. Wonderful. Thank you for that. Thank you for giving your time and association today. Look forward to hearing from you again in future. And our humble obeisances to you and my, to all the devotees. Vanchakal Patarubhyascha, Kripasindhu Bhuvayascha,
Patita Naam
Pavitra Ananta Koti Vaishnavinda Ki Jai, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai, Guru Maharaj Ki Jai, Sri Devi Mataji Ki Jai.
His Holiness Chandamouli Swami Guru Maharaj ki
jai.
Prabhupada ki
jai.
Jai. Shri Devi Mataji ki
Hari Bol.
Hari Bol. Thank you, Mataji.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Braja Vilasini and Sudha. So nice to see you all. Such a treat for me to see you all.
Nice, Mataji. Nice. Very wonderful class, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Braja Vilasini, my dear God sister. Thank you for being with me at some of the most difficult times in my life. The text messages you would send me and encourage me are invaluable and a part of my journey of growth. Thank you so much.
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Mataji.
Thank you. Sukhavaha. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. I'm sorry, I can't put my camera on, but thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. I will end the call, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.